pops into your mind when you think of amphibians? Maybe frogs and salamanders? As a general rule, most modern amphibians don't tend to weigh hundreds of kilograms. But back in the age of dinosaurs, some amphibians were huge. This group of amphibians was known as the Temnospondyls. They were a highly successful group of animals found all over the world. But by the early Cretaceous period, between 140 and 120 million years ago, there was only one species of Temnospondyl left in the world. Its name was Koolasuchus cleelandi. It clung on in southern Australia, surviving in the cold rivers and streams of the Antarctic Australian Rift Valley. Hi folks, Andrew here. Welcome to Prehistoric Australia. Today we're going to be focusing on Koolasuchus cleelandi and find out what the world was like for the last of the giant amphibians. Paleontologists believe that Koolasuchus cleelandi was the last Temnospondyl to ever live, because its fossilized remains have been found in the youngest rock formations of any Temnospondyl in the world. These rocks form part of the Wonthaggi formation, formerly known as the Umarala formation. The Koolasuchus fossils found in these rocks date to between 140 and 120 million years ago. Fossils were found on San Remo Back Beach and Rowell's Beach, along the Bass coast of southern Victoria. Brachiopoid bones that possibly belonged to Koolasuchus include several backbone vertebrae, a leg bone, shoulder girdle, ribs and clavicles. Meanwhile, the bones that almost definitely belonged to the Koolasuchus cleelandi specimen, given they were found close together, included a pair of lower jaw bones, an interclavicle, and a partial skull. Koolasuchus cleelandi was first described based on analysis of the lower jaw bones. Ridges and grooves covered the outside surfaces of the jaws, a distinct trait which classified Koolasuchus as a chigatosaurid. But it was the lack of coronoid teeth, normally present in brachiopods, which made it clear as day to scientists that Koolasuchus belonged to its own unique genera and species. Overall, by examining all these fossil bones, paleontologists have a pretty good idea of where Koolasuchus cleelandi sits in the family tree of Temnospondyls. Let's go back to the beginning, like way, way back. You've heard this story before, biological evolution. Fish crawled out of the water onto the land. To help with their conquest, they developed four legs and lungs to breathe in the air like we do. They were still bound to waterways because their eggs needed to be laid in water. These were amphibious tetrapods. 315 million years ago, some amphibious tetrapods evolved into a group known as the Temnospondyls, which Koolasuchus belongs to. They evolved robust legs and stronger backbones. Many had scales, claws, armor-like bony plates, and some were huge. After the Permian-Triassic extinction event of 250 million years ago, a more specialized group of Temnospondyls called Stereospondyli diversified in Australia and became more dependent on life in freshwater environments as opposed to land. Weaker vertebrae, shortened limbs, and eyes facing upwards atop a large, flat skull were all Stereospondyl traits that would be later inherited by Koolasuchus. But then, 200 million years ago, a mass extinction devastated this group. This cataclysm, known as the Triassic-Jurassic extinction event, destroyed most of the Stereospondyls. Throughout the Jurassic period, these animals could only be found in Asia and Australia, until eventually, just the Chigatosauridae family remained in Australia. Australia proved to be a haven for these ancient amphibians. But then, by the early Cretaceous period, 140 million years ago, the end was inevitable. There was only one species of Temnospondyl left on the planet, Koolasuchus cleelandi, living in southern Victoria, the lonely giant. The habitat of Koolasuchus was formed by recent tectonic activity. This slight rifting caused a low-lying valley to appear between the continents. It was here, in the Antarctic Australian Rift Valley, that Koolasuchus cleelandi lived. At this time, Australia was positioned much further south, and southern Victoria was within the Antarctic Circle. As a result, Koolasuchus would have survived up to 3 months of darkness during the winter, and enjoyed 3 months of continuous daylight during the summer. At the bottom of the Rift Valley were floodplains, that featured a labyrinth of cold rivers and streams. And if you would appear beneath the surface of one of these waterways, you might catch a glimpse of some very large Koolasuchus. So what do Koolasuchus look like? Well, for starters, judging from the size of its skull fragments, we know that Koolasuchus would have been big. Based on the estimated length of the skull at 65 centimeters long, the overall length of Koolasuchus was at least 3 meters long from nose to tail. Its weight has been estimated at around 500 kilograms. However, it is worth noting that without a complete skeleton of Koolasuchus, its overall length is based on the assumption that the rest of its body looked like that of other aquatic gigantosaurids. If Koolasuchus did leave the water on occasion, it probably had a sprawled posture and dragged itself over slippery surfaces using its fingertips, with its body barely moving from side to side. This unusual method of terrestrial locomotion was demonstrated in the fossil trackway of another large Temnospondyl from the early Jurassic rocks of Lesotho in South Africa. The researchers suggest that this method of locomotion was necessary because of the Temnospondyl's large head and heavy shoulders. The same would have been true of Koolasuchus. Lastly, we know that Koolasuchus had large teeth and large jaws. The shape of its teeth indicate that it was definitely carnivorous. But what was its diet? Was it a piscivore, mainly eating fish? Or was it more of an opportunistic feeder, like a crocodile ambushing small dinosaurs at the river's edge? The predatory lifestyle of Koolasuchus is largely speculative. Based on its sheer size, there is a common perception that Koolasuchus behaves similar to a crocodile, because in the original 1997 paper by Ann Warren, Tom Rich, and Patricia Vickers-Rich, Koolasuchus is suggested to have been similar to crocodilians in their overall morphology. The paper goes further to suggest that with large jaws and large teeth, Koolasuchus would have needed these traits to catch prey bigger than fish. Otherwise, why have such a big mouth? They take it a step further and suggest that Koolasuchus was an ambush predator of small dinosaurs, like a crocodile waiting at the water's edge. The implication is that its large size meant that it must have been an apex predator in its ecosystem. On the other hand, other scientists have different ideas about the potential lifestyle of Koolasuchus. On his blog in 2019, Brian G, paleontologist and Temnospondyl expert, suggested that maybe the speculative lifestyle of Koolasuchus hunting like a crocodile was casual correlation at best. He observed, simply having a flat, sometimes long skull and living in an aquatic environment does not automatically make one similar to a crocodilian. Brachiopoid amphibians like Koolasuchus had wide and short curved skulls. No crocodilian past or present has a skull shape of this resemblance. Most crocodilians are active swimmers that hunt fish and ambush unsuspecting prey near the surface. But Brian G offers an alternative lifestyle for Koolasuchus. Thick bones would have allowed the amphibian to sink to the riverbed like a rock and wait in ambush for fish. Underwater, the brachiopod's acute hearing and sensory pits between its eyes and nostrils could sense the vibrations of approaching fish. Studies have shown that many aquatic Temnospondyls, such as Gerothorax pulcherrimus, were ambush predators that would lie in wait on the riverbed. They would either grab or rapidly suck prey into their large mouths. Perhaps Koolasuchus did much the same. So was Koolasuchus an active ambush predator, like a crocodile? Or was it a sedentary ambush predator, lying in wait on the riverbed for fish? Well, we don't have enough fossil evidence to say either way. It is likely that Koolasuchus had its own unique lifestyle, unfamiliar to us today. For Koolasuchus, the birds and the bees talk would have been radically different to the one we give our kids today. Although there is no direct fossil evidence of Koolasuchus reproduction, we know from other Temnospondyl fossils how it most likely reproduced. Firstly, we know Koolasuchus would have spent the vast majority of its life cycle in water. Therefore, it likely reproduced in water through a process known as external fertilization. Basically, female Koolasuchus would lay masses of soft eggs in water, and the males would release sperm to fertilize them. In 1998, possible fossil evidence of egg masses belonging to Temnospondyls was found in the United States in Texas, dating back to the early Permian period. We know they were temnospondyl eggs because they were surrounded by a halo, most likely mucous membranes, that fish eggs just don't possess. The eggs were also attached to plant fossils, much like modern frogs. So perhaps temnospondyls like Koolasuchus laid their eggs on aquatic plants. Hopefully more fossil evidence will come to light, and then we can have a more specific conversation about the birds and the bees when it comes to Koolasuchus. Once Koolasuchus hatched out of the egg, it is unclear whether it would have undergone metamorphic growth stages like modern amphibians do. Metamorphosis is the process of undergoing dramatic physical transformations within a short period of time. There is fossil evidence for these three growth stages in temnospondyls: larval, juvenile, and adult. But this popular generalization is actually highly scrutinized by the scientific community. This is because the process of metamorphosis wasn't universal amongst all temnospondyls. While fossil evidence shows that all temnospondyls begin life as aquatic larvae, only usually terrestrial temnospondyls experience sudden and dramatic metamorphic growth stages. Those temnospondyls that remain largely aquatic, like Koolasuchus, usually experience a more gradual transition between growth stages. Once again, we'll only get further details of these developmental stages when it comes to Koolasuchus when we find more fossil evidence. One of the most incredible facts about Koolasuchus is that it was a polar resident. During the dark winter months, Koolasuchus would have had to tolerate the cold temperatures and lack of sunlight. Even at warmer times of the year, the rivers and streams remained quite nippy. So how did Koolasuchus survive the dark, harsh winters? Well, for starters, we can rule out one possibility, and that is that it hibernated on land. As Brian G pointed out, the temnospondyl's moist skin and sheer size restricted Koolasuchus to its river home. So without direct fossil evidence to infer behavior, we can look to modern day amphibians for answers about how Koolasuchus survived the winter months. Today, southern leopard frogs will hang around at the bottom of ponds and continue being active all winter, slowly swimming or moving around. To prevent ice damage to their cells, these frogs produce antifreeze in the form of high concentrations of glucose, or sugar. Wood frogs also produce antifreeze, but are even more extreme, possessing physiological adaptations that allow their bodies to be entombed in ice during the winter months. So from these modern examples, we can propose some potential survival strategies for Koolasuchus. Maybe it allowed itself to become frozen, or maybe it remained active in the cold streams during the dark winter months. We don't know for sure, but hopefully more fossil evidence will reveal light on this southern survivor. I sometimes get this feeling of melancholy when I think about long dead animals. I mean, can you imagine? At some point, there was an individual that was the last of the Koolasuchus cleelandi species. So why did this animal disappear from the world forever? Well, there are a few theories. The first theory was proposed by Warren, Rich and Rich in their original study. They suggested that Koolasuchus may have found that the Antarctic Australian Rift Valley was a safe haven from crocodilians due to its temperatures being too cold for them. If water temperatures are below 10 degrees Celsius, modern crocodilians become inactive. This was great news for Koolasuchus. Between 140 and 120 million years ago, average local temperatures ranged between negative 2 and 3 degrees Celsius. However, the local climate did not remain cold forever. The region warmed up around 113 million years ago. By this time, Koolasuchus had disappeared from the fossil record. Instead, fossil evidence of crocodilians appears at this time, in the form of two scutes and a skull bone from dinosaur cove in Victoria. Altogether, the combined evidence suggests that competition with crocodiles over resources and territory proved too much for Koolasuchus. On the surface, the fossil evidence seems compelling. Before the thermal maximum period, Koolasuchus thrived. After the thermal maximum period, crocodilians came into play. But Warren, Rich and Rich do note that there are other ways to interpret the data. Perhaps temnospondyls didn't compete with other predators like crocodilians. The fact that temnospondyls and crocodilian relatives did not replace each other in Asia is strong evidence that they coexisted. they must have occupied different ecological niches and lived in very different ways within the same environment. Brian G suggests that if Koolasuchus fed on the bottom of rivers, like a catfish, it would not have needed to compete with crocodilians hunting at the surface. If Koolasuchus and crocodilians occupied different ecological niches, then competition was probably not the cause of extinction. A second theory proposed by Warren Rich and Rich is that adult temnospondyls were relatively safe, but their larvae were fed upon by new invasive predators, such as suction-feeding fish. And Brian G proposes the third theory, suggesting that a combination of climate change and predation upon larvae resulted in the temnospondyl's demise. Why Koolasuchus died out remains a mystery. Whether its extinction was caused by competition with crocodiles, predation upon its vulnerable larvae, or even climate change itself, the fact is that Koolasuchus cleelandi remains alive in the public consciousness today. Koolasuchus cleelandi is an enigmatic amphibian. Very little is known about it, because very little fossil evidence has been uncovered. And on top of that, the last research paper to exclusively cover Koolasuchus cleelandi was published in 1997. Nevertheless, the current picture we have of Koolasuchus was probably that of a crocodile-sized chacatosaurid that patiently ambushed fish on the riverbeds of the Antarctic Australian Rift Valley. It reproduced in water, grew gradually, and survived cold winters by either remaining active or allowing itself to become frozen. And, most famously of all, it was the last of the giant amphibians. Hope you enjoyed learning about Koolasuchus. I certainly had a lot of fun writing this episode because Koolasuchus is one of my favourite prehistoric Australian animals. In fact, I love it so much that here's a photo of me in the town of Inverloch in Victoria riding a Koolasuchus. I mean, it's not every day you get to see one of those. In fact, what's the coolest prehistoric Australian animal that you've ever come face to face with? Let us know in the comments below. Also, if you like this video, feel free to like and subscribe. We always appreciate the support. In fact, if you want to support us more, feel free to make a donation on Patreon. There's lots of benefits on there, and it's always good to support the channel as well. Thanks, guys. We'll see you next time.